We all use the internet, whether it's to keep up with the latest TikTok trend or to learn more about futuristic trends, chances are you've done it all on a wireless device. But despite our devices being wireless, the internet still needs a physical connection to make its way across the globe. But how do you get a physical internet connection when over 71% of the Earth's surface is covered by ocean? Stay tuned as we figure out exactly how does the internet cross the ocean. For starters, there are more than 400 gigantic fiber optic undersea cable systems, covering a distance of more than 800,000 miles or 1.3 million kilometers, enough to wrap the entire surface of the Earth up to 31 times. What's more, the cables are buried several feet below the seabed, which can be as deep as 26,000 feet below the sea surface. Within these fiber optic cables, our social media posts and cat videos travel underwater from one place to another in the form of insanely fast light pulses. Once back on land, the data, in the form of light pulses, connects to vast land-based data centers and the fiber optic cables continue their journey on land. And although these subsea internet cables appear to be quite big and thick, the actual wires that carry the information are about the width of a human hair. The remaining cable thickness is for protection against the many hazards that could occur on the ocean's floor. For example, a sea creature might swim up and give a cable a bite, as seen by this curious shark. Or one of many human interferences could occur. Like when, in 2016, a subsea cable was accidentally damaged by fishermen, depriving many West African countries of internet for more than 2 days. Or, in 2013, when 3 ill-advised scuba divers purposefully damaged a subsea cable in the Mediterranean Sea. The US government has even consistently warned of attacks. Subsea cables' journey to the ocean floor begins when they are coiled onto vast cylindrical drums on large ocean-crossing vessels that slowly spool the cable out as they idle across the open seas. If bad weather is encountered, the captain can break off the cord, tie it to a buoy, and head for calmer water. You should also know that the subsea cables aren't just one long cable that stretches thousands of miles. Every 50 to 80 miles or so, the cables are truncated with copper-based repeaters that amplify the signal, keeping it strong enough to cross the entirety of the ocean floor. Nowadays, undersea cables are used to transmit massive amounts of digital data, and major technology companies such as Google and Facebook are responsible for more than 60% of the bandwidth used. Because of this, these major tech companies sometimes partner with each other to build their own underwater fiber optic cable systems. One such example is the upcoming 7,500-mile or 12,000-kilometer-long subsea cable known as ECHO. The purpose of the ECHO subsea cable is to create a direct, hardwired internet connection between Indonesia, Singapore, and Guam to the United States. Other tech companies will be able to rent the bandwidth on this cable for a fee. At this point, you might be wondering just why tech companies would invest hundreds of millions of their own dollars to build an undersea fiber optic cable system. Isn't that the job of a telecommunications company? Well, companies like Google, Microsoft, and Facebook usually rent bandwidth from telecommunication providers, like AT&T for instance, at exorbitant costs and have little to no control over internet speeds or latency. To get around this, these large tech companies are building their own subsea infrastructure to avoid traditional undersea cable routes that are already crowded. What's more, not only can they rent excess bandwidth to other smaller tech companies for a profit, but they can also limit internet downtime caused by extreme weather. Remember Hurricane Sandy? During the fall of 2012, this massive Category 3 hurricane not only killed over 230 people and afflicted $70 billion in damages, but the storm also destroyed a number of landing points for transatlantic subsea cables. This made communication very difficult on the U.S. Eastern Seaboard at the time and was the impetus for companies like Microsoft to consider developing their own subsea fiber optic infrastructure. Partnering with specialized telecommunications companies, Microsoft developed new subsea cable connection route between the U.S. mainland and Spain, commonly known as Marea. Once fully functional, Marea became instantly known as having the most efficient transatlantic communication speed ever, with an astonishing 155 terabytes of data being transferred per second. To put that into context, that is like streaming more than 69 million HD movies at once. The success of Marea led other tech companies to sponsor their own subsea internet cable infrastructure. And in June of 2021, Google announced the construction of a private subsea cable that would connect the United States with three countries in South America. Known as Firmina, this cable will run from the eastern seaboard of the US to cities in Argentina, Brazil, and Uruguay. The current owners of the majority of subsea cables remains to be nations and/or huge multinational corporations, the largest of which is US-based AT&T, which holds an astounding 140,000 miles of undersea cable. The second largest is China Telecom. Facebook and Google currently operate about 62,000 miles of undersea cables each. It's also common for cables to be owned by a consortium of up to 50 or more interested parties that divvy up the costs and maintenance responsibilities. But what about Starlink? Aren't Elon Musk and his team coming up with a way to deliver high-speed internet to everyone on the planet using a massive amount of synced satellites? If you'd like to know more about that project, then be sure to leave the hashtag Starlink in the comments.